I'm going to take you through a very quick and brief tour of a few misadventures I've been going through in my part of the world, doing what I do most of the time, which is building. And we'll start from the beginning, as I did a good part of my education, at least my architectural education, in the U.S. I was brought back to my hometown about 1993. At the time, the city was mostly represented by images like this, which were extremely, extremely attractive and circulated a lot. So there was a lot of aura around the war and the impact of the war on our city, and a lot of these images circulated a lot. So my coming back to Beirut coincided with the so-called reconstruction period. Right before going back to Lebanon, I worked on an exercise that also dealt very closely with the scars of the war, and this project was called Evolving Scars. It was about the recuperation and the mutation of the ruins, whatever you want to call them, the cadavers of the war. These buildings that were basically too damaged to be recuperated. And my idea was to turn this into an architectural exercise, basically through a process of registering memories of citizens and demolishing these buildings as the memories were being collected. More importantly for me, when I look back at this over 20 years later, I realized that it was probably the first architecture I know about that is about the demolition process. We architects usually work on erecting matter, but it is very strange that at that point in time, in my early 20s, I was interested in doing exactly the opposite and trying to turn that into architecture. So Evolving Scars was a project that to me was very important because it was my sort of comeback to Beirut. But you can imagine that going back to Beirut with ideas about making architecture through demolition of buildings didn't get me a lot of work. People didn't want to work with me because when you go to an architect, you want him to build something for you, you don't want him to demolish something for you. But this was more importantly also an exercise about trying to formulate some sort of history, formulating our own history, dealing with memory. Obviously, nothing of that really happened in reality. So I spent most of my time in Beirut in my early years in bars, very often doing a lot of work, but very much involved in the entertainment industry, which recuperated me a few years later. So I did not build any museums, I did not build any public housing, schools, universities, or any serious buildings. And after after 3 to 4 years, I was recuperated by the entertainment industry. This was the first building I ever built. It's a nightclub. So you see on the left part of the image, the club in action, and then when the club is about to go to sleep, the sun comes up, and the people who are in there are in a pretty bad shape. This building is located in a very problematic site, which is called the Quarantina. The quarantine of the port of Beirut, formerly the quarantine of the port of Beirut, which was a refugee camp, was burned down to the ground in 1976. So how do you come back some 20 years later to build a club over a site which has quite a macabre aura? So this is a photo of the camp, I think around the 1920s, which in fact started as being an Armenian refugee camp, and then became a Palestinian refugee camp after 1948. The club is really an instrument of pleasure, so it's not really a memorial for the war or anything of that sort, but it's also a will to put a finger on things that are part of our history or our recent past. It's mainly a building that is stuck into the ground, about 3.5 meters into the soil, so in elevation it's completely flat. This was the first building I ever built. It has a retractable roof. You see it open, so when the building wakes up, it wakes up at night when the sun goes down, and it opens up its roof, and then when the sun comes up, it goes to sleep. The roof recesses, so up, down, down. And It doesn't look much like a building. I built this with artisans, and when I built this thing, initially I had no prior professional experience, so I had to resort to garbage truck builders and people that had nothing to do with the construction industry, see, during the day and then at night. This is a club from inside, and this is me at the far left corner. And this is our Prime Minister, Rafil Hariri, who this caption was taken in a film that was done about him a few years before his assassination. After working on this first music club that was quite a successful venture as a music club, I got tagged as an entertainment architect. You know, people always have these tags on them, people have to frame you. So the second project was also another entertainment destination, but this time also in a very problematic zone, right close to what was formerly the Green Line separating East and West Beirut, on a building that was completely, pretty much destroyed by the war. It had no roof left. And what we've done is encased this building in a wire cage, added a roof to it, which we inhabited with a bar. This was also a very close collaboration with artisans. It's a restaurant and a bar, essentially. And what you see here is really an attempt to make poetry out of the decay of this building. So I did not rehabilitate its skin, I did not replaster its facades, but I let it rot, and I encased it in a cage. This was the initial setup of the restaurant. Initially, it was one huge table that looks more like a pastoral table than just a stupid restaurant where you just go and eat. And that's the bar, obviously, which reconfirmed my label as also not only the entertainment architect, but as the architect of comfortable roofed buildings. And that's the bar. My third project for the entertainment industry was a Japanese restaurant on the former Green Line on the Damascus Road, where you see a very absurd situation. Right next door to us was a building that was squatted by refugees living with no windows, no doors, no running water, and here we were planting a structure for a sushi restaurant that was going to serve food at $50 a pop when the refugees next door, or the squatters next door, were living off 150 or 200 bucks a month. So there's something very maybe immoral or very difficult, very impossible about such missions. But my work is mainly about really, is an anti-denial sort of posture where I recognize these very difficult conditions and I try to work through them, pervert them, flip them around. So this is Yabani, this is not a photo montage. What you see to the left is a real situation of the squatters, and to the right is our restaurant, where once you're inside, you're in complete denial, you're in a forced situation of denial of your immediate surroundings, and your only relationship to the outside is the sky and nothing but the sky. And the people here are enjoying their sushi at $50 a pop, or literally behind the wall is a drastically different situation. I venture sometimes into very, very small scale interventions. This is an art piece we did, an installation we did with a video for the Sandretto Foundation about 3-4 years ago. It's part of a show. It's called Prisoner of War. It's a military device that was conceived to exchange prisoners of war through demarcation lines. It actually works. It's a very disturbing video, so I'll spare you this. And from that, we've produced pieces. So there's always a going back and forth to issues that deal with our recent past, with the difficulties of trying at least to formulate some sort of history in an environment where there's no consensual history, where we have not really agreed on any sort of history or common history. In the meantime, Beirut was rebuilt, or the city center, the former city center was rebuilt by the private sector, and you get these sort of very polished images of what Beirut has registered officially as being historical. So it's interesting to see that Beirut recognizes as history, as part of history. Obviously, the six layers, archaeological layers that are under the former city center, and they go from the Phoenicians through Rome and all the way through the Ottoman Empire, and immediately the French period, say 1920s, 1940s, history ends there. There's no history beyond that. That's very strange. It's as if the first years of the Republic from 1943 and on were not part of history. So I'm somebody who is firmly grounded into the present. And for me, history starts with the present. And from that point, you can obviously reformulate the past. This is another, the other sort of images you will see circulating about Beirut. So there's the polished, there's the war we've talked about, those sort of cliches. There's the postcard history cliche, and there's the debauchery of Beirut. It's nightlife, it's bimbos. And somehow, I'm part of all of that. I produced, as I was saying earlier, sometimes small interventions that are not necessarily purely within the limits of my profession, so they can be installations. This was for the Maxi Museum in Rome, an art installation we did that's called Derailing Beirut. It starts with studying points in the city and trying to map the city through points that have been fetishized or through points that are producing images that circulate a lot about Beirut in the present, and trying to establish links between these in an attempt to write history. So about the fetishization of war, the Holiday Inn Hotel remains one of the very visible scars of the war, which is still there. So we've imagined a circuit that would go through the hotel in and out at a fast speed, and then we've connected these points and tried to see what the city would look like with this roller coaster-like sort of tracks. And we've imagined that the track would be, this would be a track for a capsule that tourists could take to tour the city at a very high speed. Their head would be placed where the detonator of the bomb is, so that they could consume the city at a very fast pace. We've produced this little contraption. It's now a part of the permanent collection of the Maxi in Rome. And we've produced images of that. This is the porter who rolls this thing around the city waiting for the next tourist to come, but obviously the tourist never shows up. But I also build permanent, more sort of serious architectures. This is a twin sort of chalet in the mountain ski resort, high up in altitude, about 2,000 meters high. This is a building that has no facade. It has an inclined facade that is facing the street with two accesses, left and right, and one straight flight of stairs that goes up to a pool in which you can float at over 2,000 meters of altitude and literally have a 360-degree view over the mountains all around. It's quite an interesting sensation. Again, on the more domestic front, this is an intervention we did in Beirut, where it's a very simple story. You can circulate every apartment, you can circulate from any room to any other room, to the kitchen, to the living room. Kids can wake up in the morning, go down, grab a glass of water in the kitchen, pick up something in the living room and go down and see their parents without ever walking inside. But this happening completely on the facade. And it's a bit reminiscent of the very Mediterranean dwellings up until the first half of the 20th century, where we were very much in contact with the street, or the neighborhoods. And this scenario sort of projects itself to the facade. This is my flower pot building. Again, with very, very small, very humble means, I think about $20 a pot. We managed to do a green screen or a green curtain on the facade. It's not a green wall, it's a very primitive green curtain which sort of floats on the street. This is under construction right now. I would say it's halfway between entertainment and dwelling. They're basically lofts, lofts, open spaces. But the particularity of this building is that you can drive your car into your living room. So you can drive your car up into the building, it's sort of lifted up, and then you push a button and you drive your car into the living room. And it is under construction. So there was a developer that was daring enough to follow me on this. I will take you very briefly through one of my latest ventures. We're working on a hotel in Beirut with a very particular, very eccentric client who wanted to project his idea of Beirut and not the very sugar-coated version of what Beirut should be. So we tried to summarize this with a few sentences. Beirut is a city in the making where the crane is everywhere, it's always been. Beirut is a city where we dance in the sky and people, we also dine in the sky. This is a TV show. We have a Ferris wheel, which is really part of the city fabric. I see Beirut as a very radical city and a very contemporary city. Beirut has a lot of symbols, and very importantly, Beirut is a port, and it's a very superstitious city, and it needs heroes. It has a lot of them, but it keeps generating heroes. So we did a building that literally translates these ideas of that my client thought Beirut was about, and it's that building to the left, right above the port. And here you see it on your way into the city, and you see the two things up there are huge cranes that can lift up to 30 tons. And the idea, what you see to the right, is that you can lift a bar, which can host about 100 people, up in the air, 150 meters high. And they can literally fly in the sky until they get a great view of the sea and stop for a while, get a drink, and then come back. So lots of parts of this building that move. You see it. Now it's stuck on a terrace, and then it flies up. See, boom, 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 boom. See, you're on the street here. Boom, 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 boom. And you can even fly or float above the city. So there's a pool that is also taken up in the air. It's a small lap pool. If you put your goggles on, the bottom of the pool has windows and you can literally fly above the city at night. You see? Like a bird. This is my studio. It's a cross-section in my workspace. And a lot of the cadavers, the projects I haven't produced, are floating up around it. I love machines. I'm fascinated by machines. I'm a biker. So this is where I work, and this is the cemetery of my work, where I collect all my unbuilt projects in a pod that you can visit and go through. Now it sits in my office. The man hung by the balls is the ex-British ambassador of Lebanon. Thank you very much.